thank you for inviting me here. I'm really happy to be here and speak to you about federal efforts in Alzheimer's disease-related research. First, I'm going to give you a little bit of background about NIH and NIA in general, in case anyone's not familiar with it. I'm going to be talking about the National Alzheimer's Project Act and several related activities that I think are really having a great impact on the way that Alzheimer's disease is being both researched and treated in this country, and also globally, I should say. I'm going to give some examples of NIA-funded research on cognitive assessment, behavior in neurodegenerative disease, including FTD, and I'm going to briefly touch on some information about Down syndrome, and then I'm going to mention several resources. And throughout, as I present various types of information, I have pulled several bits of the information that I have in here from different sources, so I'm going to try to point out where I've gotten those so that you can find them yourself later. So this is a particularly kind of ugly slide, but it gives you an idea. There are 27 institutes and centers within NIH. I'm at the National Institute on Aging, which we have up here on the top left. This is in your slide set, but a couple pages in, sorry. And there are, some of the institutes are focused on particular diseases. Some are focused on particular body parts, like the National Eye Institute. And then our institute and the Child Health are focused on particular parts of the lifespan. So it runs the gamut. We have the National Library of Medicine and the Clinical Center, Fogarty International Center. So a lot of different pieces to the National Institutes of Health. So as I said, I'm in the National Institute on Aging, and all of the NIH institutes have both an intramural program where they actually do the research at NIH and an extramural program where they fund research across the country and also internationally. And so I'm in the extramural program and administer grants primarily in the United States. And we have four divisions: Division of Aging Biology, Division of Behavior and Social Research, Division of Neuroscience, and Division of Geriatrics and Clinical Gerontology, and I'm in the Division of Neuroscience. So just as a little bit of background, and again, I'll be happy to answer any questions about any of this afterwards. So moving on to the National Alzheimer's Project Act, it was signed into law in January of 2011. It requires the Secretary of HHS, the Department of Health and Human Services, to establish the National Alzheimer's Project. It requires an annually updated national plan submitted to Congress on how to overcome Alzheimer's disease, annual recommendations for priority actions to both improve health outcomes for individuals with Alzheimer's and lower costs to families and government programs. The annual evaluation of all federally funded efforts in Alzheimer's research, care, and services, along with their outcomes. And the creation of an advisory council on Alzheimer's research, care, and services. And this advisory council meets, I think it's three times a year. I usually attend those in person, but it's open to the public to either attend in person or they webcast all of the meetings. So if Alzheimer's is an area of interest and you have an interest in what's going on the federal level, I would recommend taking a look. The website's not that great, but you can still find materials usually. It's got a lot of information about what's going on federally. And there's also always a public comment session part of the meeting. Wow, I'm really sorry that's hard to see. Anyway, so you can get a lot of information from that about what's going on. The goals of the national plan are, number one, to prevent and effectively treat Alzheimer's disease by 2025. This is an extremely ambitious goal. I think that although this is a great time of hope and there's a lot going on in research and there's actually, surprisingly at this time, increases in federal funding for Alzheimer's research, it's still considered an extremely ambitious goal, but we're working on it. Number two, to enhance care quality and efficiency. Number three, to expand supports for people with Alzheimer's disease and their families. Number four, to enhance public awareness and engagement. And number five, to improve data to track progress. So these have been the five goals since the national plan came out. So goal number one, if you remember, was to prevent and effectively treat Alzheimer's disease by 2025. Within that goal, we have these five sub-goals: identify research priorities and milestones, expand research aimed at preventing and treating Alzheimer's disease, accelerate efforts to identify early and pre-symptomatic stages of Alzheimer's disease, coordinate research with international public and private entities, facilitate translation of findings into medical practice and public health programs. We do have quite a lot of research across the board, I mean across internationally. A lot of research happens and there are positive results, but then moving those results into actual practice is seems to be a block in doing that. And so I think it's great that they put that in the plan to make sure that we can try to do that. And there have been already some really good efforts to do that. So in service of trying to develop priorities and milestones in terms of the research goal, we held a summit at NIH campus in May of 2012. This was the first one in service of the National Alzheimer's Plan. It had six sessions, and it was really kind of focused on trying to find a treatment. So the information, the recommendations that came from this are available online. It was a really great meeting, and also the video from that meeting is available. Then in 2013, I had the privilege of helping to organize this Alzheimer's disease-related dementias that was run by a different institute at NIH, the NINDS, National Institute for Neurological Disorders and Stroke. And that one had five sessions. I worked primarily on the fifth session on health disparities in AD-related dementias. I think because it's called the National Alzheimer's Project Act, and we have the Alzheimer's Association that's very vocal, even though their actual name is Alzheimer's and Related Dementias Association, a lot of people are kind of missing out on the non-Alzheimer's dementias, and a lot of information is not getting out about that. And some of the other organizations like AFTD, Alzheimer's Association for Frontotemporal Dementia, they've been present at some of the advisory council meetings for NAPA to help spread the word that, you know, there are these other dementias, and a lot of people providing primary care aren't even really aware of them and don't know how to diagnose them. So that's also part of why this is very important to get this information out. And then just this past February, we had the second Alzheimer's Summit. And this one I also helped to work on, I'm proud to say, especially if you might be interested in sessions 4 and 5, Innovating Disease Monitoring, Assessment, and Care, and session 5, Empowering Patients and Engaging Citizens. I think those two sessions kind of moved the conversation a little bit from just a focus on treatment to kind of some of the other issues that are related to what gets encountered on a daily basis for people like you who work with people that are suffering from dementia and their families. So I thought it was a really great meeting. This is also available online, video from it, and there will be summary recommendations. This just happened last month, so we're working to get those recommendations out. Oops. So now I'm gonna move on to this CADRO and IDROP. We have been working since actually before the National Alzheimer's Project Act came out. This was an effort between NIA, the National Institute on Aging, and the Alzheimer's Association. We started out just focused on our own portfolios of research, trying to find ways to understand what they were funding and what we were funding and whether there were good ways to kind of send people back and forth where younger investigators might get one of their new investigator research awards and then move into an NIH R01. And so we looked through years and years of our own funding and developed this common Alzheimer's disease research ontology. And that's also available online. and International Alzheimer's Disease Research Portfolio. Once we had created the categories, we set up this eyedrop. And so here are the categories. Category A, molecular pathogenesis and physiology of Alzheimer's disease. Category B, diagnosis, assessment, and disease monitoring. Category C, translational research and clinical interventions. Category D, epidemiology. And category E, care support and health economics of Alzheimer's disease. Those are the five Alzheimer's research categories. And then we have resources, consortia, and now we have the related dementias in there too. So this is just an example to give you a feel for the kinds of things that are in it. And we have categories, as I mentioned, and then within the categories, we have what we're calling research topics. So you can see within category E, here are some examples. And then within those, underneath the topics, we have research themes. And this is meant to be a dynamic system in the sense that as the research fields change, we will be changing our categories. So this was based on kind of a retrospective of what had been funded in the past. And we're constantly evaluating and we're going to be updating the categories in the near future. So I hope you'll take a look and give us some feedback, see if the kind of research you might be interested in is in there. And let us know if you don't like, for example, we have this cultural values and beliefs. And when we set it up, we were looking at our own portfolio. So we have, as you heard in my introduction, I've done a lot of work with Native Americans. We have American Indian as a theme in there. And then we started working internationally. So like Australia, they don't have American Indians, they have Aboriginals. So we have, you know, some updating to do just to make it global, but also to make it fit with current research. And I'm not going to discuss these in depth, but we do have a couple publications to give you some further information about those. So this is the online eyedrop tracking AD research milestones. Now that we developed this, as I said, before the plan came out, but it has been a centerpiece in the ability to look internationally at what is being funded, where there are areas of overlap, where there are gaps, where some places are able to do certain kinds of research and other places aren't. And I did want to be sure to mention, since one of the earlier speakers mentioned Virginia has funding, I actually contacted most of the states, and we do have Virginia in here. We have the research that's funded by Virginia in our eyedrop database. So, I should have said, under reports and publications, if you were to be on the website and click on that, you can see how the summit recommendations from that 2012 summit that I mentioned are included in here, and it allows us to look at how the recommendations are being addressed in the current research. And they're linked to the CADRO codes that I described before. And then you can drill down and see how the AD research milestones are linked to specific funded research projects. So now I'm going to move on to examples of NIA-funded research on cognitive assessment. There's quite a bit more, of course, than what I'm just presenting here. These are just a couple examples. These are from my own portfolio, so I'm a little more familiar with them. And here's an example of where I'm showing you how to use one of the resources that you may not be aware of. This is called the NIH Reporter, and the internet address is circled in red there. You can use that to search for anything you want. You can search by keywords, you can search by state, you can search by congressional district, you can search by PI, anything you want. So this example that I pulled up is at NYU, Dr. James Galvin, and his study is multicultural community dementia screening. And he was one of the primary developers of this 88 dementia screening interview. It's 8 yes or no questions. And part of the purpose of doing it that way is to try to help be more culture fair. A lot of the ways that are currently used, especially the MMSE, the Mini Mental State Exam, that are used in common practice are very, there are some difficulties with using them across different populations. And also, that the MMSE and several others take 10 minutes or so, and busy primary care practices don't really have 10 minutes to spend on that one topic. So this is an interview. It can be done either with a person or with someone who's come along with them that takes care of them. To answer yes or no, have these things changed in the last several years? And so, for example, losing interest in hobbies, forgetting the correct month or year, trouble handling complicated finances. So just 8 questions, yes or no, has it changed in the last few years? And he's looking in the different populations. He's at NYU. And so this is ongoing research to try out this tool and see how it works in these different populations. In addition, some of you may be familiar with the United States Preventive Services Task Force. They make recommendations on screening. And they have recommended in the past, and in one that just came out recently, I think it was this past October, that there's not enough evidence to screen as a general practice older adults for a cognitive impairment. So this is just kind of their statement about that. There's not enough evidence. We don't have the evidence. So actually, NIA is funding in Indiana to look at what are the impacts of giving someone a cognitive assessment. We don't actually know for sure that it helps. And you know, some people may become anxious even just at the idea of being assessed. Some people may not follow up. There are a lot of different things that can go on. And so they're doing actually this randomized trial to look at whether screening for cognitive impairment ends up in better outcomes in the end. So that's another example of ongoing research. And then we worked with this group because one of the problems with screening is, of course, no matter what assessment tool you use, there will be some people who get a positive result, but they're actually not cognitively impaired. And so we worked with these several different groups working on multiple large studies in different populations to develop and validate a dementia screening indicator. So what they did was they looked across all their data over many, many years to figure out who is most likely to get a true positive result. And they have this kind of weighted risk indicator. So if somebody is 65 and doesn't really have any other related health issues like diabetes or heart issues, you know, other cardiovascular issues, their weight is fairly normal, they're unlikely to have dementia if they don't have any of the other risk factors that are associated with dementia. So this way, people who shouldn't really be screened because they're unlikely to have dementia wouldn't be screened. So this is available also online, the actual risk indicator. So now I'm going to move on to research on behavior in neurodegenerative disease. And I'm going to give some examples of both pharmacologic and non-pharmacologic interventions, and also ones that are completed and ones that are in progress. So this one is actually completed, and again, I'm illustrating different sources of information. Let's see if I can point with this. No. Okay. The one on the left is citalopram for agitation in Alzheimer's disease. This is an example of a clinical trial. The one on the left is from the ADEER Center, the Alzheimer's Disease Education and Referral Center, and I'm going to be giving you some more information about that, but they have a page where you can look up clinical trials. And this, again, is a completed one, and I've shown the publication on the right, just giving the general overview, and then the conclusion. It actually was a positive trial. It showed some positive, helpful results. So here I wanted to include, as one of the earlier speakers mentioned, non-pharmacologic management actually has more positive results than some of the pharm stuff. So I thought this was really important to illustrate. I think most people in the field are familiar with the REACH study. That is another way of helping people care and manage symptoms of dementia. But this is Laura Gitlin, who's now at Hopkins in Baltimore, has done extensive work on this non-farm management, and she is also doing her work in the community in diverse populations, and has shown some really strong positive results. So I encourage you to take a look at some of that work if you're not familiar with it. Here is another ongoing clinical trial looking at prazosin for disruptive agitation in Alzheimer's disease. This is from a group in Seattle working partially at the VA and partially at the Alzheimer's Center in Seattle. This is an example of repurposing. This is a drug that's already in use for treating people with high blood pressure. And they've had some preliminary results and some reason to think that it might help with agitation, so they're taking a look at that. And again, another resource, clinicaltrials.gov. I imagine most of you are familiar, but just another place to find out information about ongoing research. This is a drug being used for depression in Alzheimer's disease. So I just, again, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, frontotemporal dementia is another dementia. It's not getting too much attention. We do have this publication. I meant to mention that I have a pile of stuff over there. You're welcome to take any of that. And these are all also available. You can order them online, or feel free to stop by since you're relatively close to visit us at NIA. We have a lot of information that's available both for care providers and for the people that you might see, the families and the people with any of these cognitive impairment or neurodegenerative diseases. So this example that I pulled up is from the UC San Francisco. They have an Alzheimer's Center and they have a focus on FTD. And they have a huge amount of information, again, both for people with the disease and for their families. And for care providers. So they actually have, all of the Alzheimer's centers have education cores, and part of their goal is to provide outreach and information within their community where they are, and also internationally if possible through the web, about neurodegenerative diseases in general. And then finally, I wanted to mention Down syndrome. I don't know how many people are aware, but people with Down syndrome, when they live, which they are now doing, living much longer, as they get older, they have a very much increased chance of developing Alzheimer's disease. And it is Alzheimer's disease. It has genetic relationship to the APP gene that is that causes an increase in amyloid that we think is part of the cause of Alzheimer's disease. So what I'm showing here is a funding opportunity announcement from NIA that we also worked with NICHD, the National Institute for Child Health and Human Development, looking at biomarkers of Alzheimer's disease in Down syndrome. And this is an area that's picking up quite a lot in terms of research. I think at first people might have been a little concerned about doing research with people with Down syndrome, but they're asking for it. I mean, people are very concerned, and you know, of course, the parents are getting older too, and they're concerned that their child that's now becoming an adult is going to also develop Alzheimer's disease. So it's a pretty serious problem, and we're trying to do what we can to work in this population as well. And then this is, I don't know how many people here actually do research on Alzheimer's, but we have this Alzheimer's disease pilot clinical trials opportunity where, you know, if you have an idea, if you're not generally a researcher, but you've seen something that you think works, you might be able to partner with someone who actually does do research in this field. This is a great opportunity. It's very broad. It includes tools that can be used in clinical trials. It includes, again, non-farm and lots of other information. So you can look this up and I can help you if you're unable to find it, but great opportunity for people interested in doing research and trying stuff out. These are pilot clinical trials, so they can be smaller. And then now I'm kind of moving to a different section where I'm just presenting information that NIA has available. We have information for care providers, and I did bring several of these. I also helped work on this, Assessing Cognitive Impairment in Older Patients. It's supposed to be a quick guide for primary care. It has a lot of information. You know, we think, even though we don't know for sure that screening is a good idea, we do know that there are a lot of people as the Alzheimer's Association will tell you, who are not getting a diagnosis. They have frank dementia, and 50% of them are not being told that they have the disease, and sometimes primary care providers aren't even recognizing that the person is demented. They have very short time, and so we provide information here and here, some other instrument. We've developed this database, instruments to detect cognitive impairment in older adults. And there are tons of them out there. Some of them are longer, some of them are shorter, but this database actually allows you to search through. You can use time as a search term, time to administer. You can use who can administer it. So we have this whole large database of instruments. We have also information for families, and I just kind of grabbed a screenshot just listing some of what's available, but there's really a lot of information here, and I would encourage you, if you're working with people with dementia and their families, to take a look at what's available. I do have some of them over here, some of our more popular ones, but they really are very helpful and provide a lot of information and resources within those. And then one of the other issues that I'm kind of passionate about is trying to promote research participation, not just in Alzheimer's disease research, but in general. I think it's really important for us to have a good representation of people, especially older adults, participating in research of all kinds. And I always try to not just say clinical trials. You don't necessarily have to take a drug, but try to get people that you work with to think about the possibility of participating in research. And we also do need people without any impairment to participate in a lot of these studies. So we have this new webpage about promoting research participation. This particular one is the other new slide that I added, so you won't find this one in there. But we do also have a booklet, which I think I have over there, Participating in Alzheimer's Research, that has a lot of information about what's involved in Alzheimer's research studies. And then I think this is my last slide, recruiting older adults into research. This is a project I worked on with the CDC and the Administration for Community Living. We were using their networks of service providers and public health networks to get this information out about participating in research. And we started with Alzheimer's disease, but we're really trying to convey information about research participation. Really trying to encourage people to participate. So I think that's it, and I'll be happy to take questions on any of these or other topics. Thank you.
Just a simple question about information for families. Did you say that we could find this somewhere online, maybe?
Yes, there's a whole list of publications. If you go to that ADEAR website, A-D-E-A-R, Alzheimer's Disease Education and Referral, you know, if you use Google and do ADEAR publications, you'll see a whole long listing of them. And there's a whole bunch over here you should take a look at. You can grab one. I think they have the webpage on most of those, too.
Thank you.
Other questions?
In your experience, how much information are physicians and other practitioners getting about the disease? And is there, you know, a movement to have physicians more educated about this? Or because as we work with the county, so we rely on the physicians to provide a lot of the information or, you know, diagnose our clients. But if they aren't, you know, they're not necessarily going to listen to the social worker from the county. You know, it has to come from a higher place. So I just wonder, you know, are you seeing more and more becoming more educated about it, or is it kind of at a standstill?
There are several efforts underway, mostly as part of this National Alzheimer's Project Act. There's also geriatric education centers across the country, in addition to the Alzheimer's centers that I mentioned that have education programs. They're really trying to spread this message, and the Alzheimer's Association just put out their facts and figures that mention the statistic that about 50% of people with dementia are not being given a diagnosis. And it even, we hear a lot of cases where people are being prescribed medication that is designed for cognitive impairment, and they haven't received the full workup to even determine the cause of the cognitive impairment, and they're not told what or at least they don't know what the medication is for. I mean, it could be if they're actually very impaired, they're getting this prescription, And they have been told, but they forgot. I mean, that's certainly part of it. But the Alzheimer's Association in their facts and figures points out that that's not what the issue is, and that's certainly not the whole thing. So it's definitely a problem, and there are definitely lots of efforts to try to improve that situation. We're trying to put out this information. We're trying to fund research on the importance of the assessments. We're trying to fund research on different assessment tools. And the HHS has a website called alzheimers.gov that also has some information so that families can be more informed, and then they can say, hey, I understand, you know, that this can sometimes be an issue, and I think my spouse is having these problems. Could you please check this? So we're trying to kind of spread the message in every way possible.
And to add on to that, I know for us in the inpatient hospitalization, we've kind of had this catch-22 because we have a lot of families coming in and saying, I notice my loved one is having all of these problems, and we're looking at doing a lot of the testing when they're in, but we have a hard time saying we've done a lot of the testing, but we can't validate because of overlying conditions, and then trying to push to have that follow-up testing done kind of outpatient because we have the concern of overlying delirium or whatever else may be going on. And so we're having a little bit of that pushback with family to say, you know, we suspect that some of your concerns are valid, but because of a potential overlying, you know, infection, delirium that may be going on, and trying to separate out the two. So, you know, inpatient, we can start some of the testing, but ultimately have to say, you have to follow outpatient to kind of confirm some of this. Has been kind of hard too with some of these families who kind of want an answer right there.
Right. Well, I'm not quite sure how to solve that problem. I mean, it sounds like you're doing what you can in the current situation. We are also funding research on care coordination, and there are a couple publications out. So I'd be interested to hear if you have suggestions on what would be helpful. We do have information about care coordination, but a lot of it is policy and systems issues. So the National Alzheimer's Project Act, the council is actually made up of, you know, members from CMS, VA, you know, lots of different government organizations that are trying to do what they can to improve some of these kinds of issues. So it is part of it, but trying to convey information from a hospital setting to the person's primary care is a communications issue. And if the family is at least aware that there might be a problem, you know, I think that's pretty hopeful. And you know, what we do what we can to provide information, maybe you can direct them to some of these resources that might help them. We have a publication, I think I have one copy here, talking with your physician. We have also ones for physicians talking with your older patient. So there's information, but it's a matter of, as I said, getting it out. So
we'll pick up the phone and call them. When they get to us as the geriatrics team, I mean, we'll pick up the phone and call the primary care and do that team-to-team communication. It's just unfortunate that a lot of times some of this cognitive decline may be what's ultimately led to the hospitalization with medication confusion and stuff like that. So,
Other questions?
Hi, Nina. That's been very informative. One of the things Ed Ancelo and I were talking about is these websites are helpful, but how would I get to what I'd be interested in as like care coordination and systems and policy? Could you maybe, Terry said we could go to the website, kind of walk us through how to navigate a little bit, kind of a show and tell, because otherwise you get on a website and you indicate there's ways
you want me to do it up here, you mean?
Yeah, that would be great.
Okay, so this is the ADHERE website, Alzheimer's Disease Education and Referral Center, and you can see there are different categories: caregiving, disability, doctor-patient communication, end of life, exercise, healthy aging and longevity, legal and financial planning, memory and cognitive health, men's health, women's health. So it's clicked right now on Alzheimer's disease. We have the fact sheet, genetics fact sheet, medications, knowing when to ask for help. And then I have this caring for a person with Alzheimer's disease, I think over there, quite a few copies, preventing Alzheimer's disease. In terms of care coordination, I'm not sure that we have a publication on that, because that's this, I do know a couple, and I can maybe email them to you to pass around, but they're in journals like JAMA and stuff like that. So I don't know if those kind of articles would be helpful. I'm happy to share them. Yes, we have a question back there.
Could you give us some idea of what agencies or organizations are doing a major thrust in medical schools and in residency programs to educate primary care providers, especially in diagnosis, recognition, treatment?
Yeah, so it's actually not, it's a very small part of what NIA does. It's actually a different government agency, HRSA, which I always forget what it's, Health Research Services Administration, I think. They actually fund the geriatric education centers that I mentioned, and there are, I don't remember how many, a large number of them across the country. And they are working as also, again, part of the National Alzheimer's Project Act to really improve the continuing education and the general medical school awareness of some of these issues. So it's definitely part of it, and it's definitely improving, but it will be slow. There was also an Institute of Medicine meeting a while ago about the decline in the availability of primary care and other care providers for because of the geriatric population growing so much. So it's going to continue to be a problem for quite a long time. I think we had another question up here.
Yeah, I worked at the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, and we were really focusing on person-centered care and trying to look at behavior to try and help the dignity and the self-determination and to not agitate, but to try and address some of these problems. Is there any, in your behavioral package, is there any research that's really looking at kind of the behaviors that try and help that person that has a diagnosis that can't be cured but has to be managed? And then secondly, are you really looking at mental illness along with dementia and how to better address that?
Do you mean people aging with an existing mental illness?
Yeah.
That is, you remember how I put up the four different divisions of NIA? That's not really part of our division, so I don't know as much about it, I'm sorry to say. But in terms of treatments for people with different types of dementia and their various behaviors, that was what I tried to give a few examples of. There's both pharmacological, and we have some ongoing trials, some completed trials. And then we also have quite a bit of work on non-pharmacological management and help for caregivers as well. So I think we have a pretty broad approach to that, but it's certainly one of the large problems. And there's more to it. If you take a look at that first 2012 summit I mentioned, that was part of that summit was focusing on behavioral issues as well. There's another question back there.
Yes, I noticed you mentioned that one of your goals is to prevent and effectively treat Alzheimer's disease by 2025. And I was just curious to know what are some of the preventive methods that you've identified to help sort of combat this disease?
Well, that's a big question. well, I encourage you to take a look at the summit, but they're looking, actually, let me put that slide back up. Okay, so the first session was interdisciplinary approach to discovering and validating the next generation of therapeutic targets. So a lot of the research field has been focused on amyloid and the amyloid hypothesis, and there's still quite a lot of work going on in that area, but part of the goal here was to try to broaden dramatically what other options are being looked at. Challenges in preclinical therapy development, trying to look at some of the animal models and whether they're appropriate and how they're being used. There's been a lot of work done on looking at the rigor of the animal research that precedes the human research and whether those approaches are the best way to get us to an answer. And then the third session, who to treat, when to treat, and what outcomes to measure. Some of the ideas of why some of the previous trials have failed have to do with who's in the group being tested. And you know, we're getting much better at learning more of this precision medicine idea that there are genetic groupings and there are lifestyle groupings and people with, you know, all kinds of differences that we can now kind of determine. It may be that Alzheimer's disease is very, it is the case that Alzheimer's disease is very heterogeneous. There are a lot of different, there may be different kinds of Alzheimer's disease, or at least different expressions of it or different causes of it. And so this was kind of a session trying to look at all these potential differences and how to sort through them and make sure that when you're testing a therapy, you're testing it on the right people for that kind of therapy. And then session four was drug repurposing and combination therapy. So trying to think about, as I mentioned, one example of a drug that's already in use for one purpose, trying to see if maybe since we already know about the safety of those drugs, that we might be able to use some of those at least to treat some of the symptoms of Alzheimer's disease and the other dementias. And then there was a whole session on non-farm interventions at this one. And then new models of public-private partnerships, because of course, even with our increase in funding, which we didn't have at that time, there's so much work to be done that we need to kind of pull out all the stops and try to figure out what the best ways are to fund all this different type of research. There are a lot of great ideas that are going unfunded because there just isn't enough funding to do all this important work. Does that help to answer your question? Okay, other questions?
Dr. Silverberg, I wanted to ask you specifically back to the research that's being supported in Indiana and this whole issue that the Preventive Services Task Force has revisited on a few occasions about screening. I know many of us are encounter family members, well, individuals with unrecognized dementia and family members who've been involved in their care who experience a lot of consequences of unrecognized dementia related to draining of financial resources or lack of opportunity for advanced care planning, issues like that. So I'm just curious, could you talk a little bit more about what outcomes you think will be looked at in that particular trial or other attention around whether or not we should elevate, you know, formal cognitive screening?
I didn't catch the
last part. What outcomes will be looked at beyond just what happens to this someone's clinical individual progression? Well, are there other dimensions that will be looked at in trials about whether or not cognitive screening should take place?
Right. So I don't recall off the top of my head all of their measures, but I do know one of the many that they're looking at is cost. So even just the cost of the rest of their care. When you have unrecognized cognitive impairment, you're worse at taking your medications. As you mentioned, there are all kinds of other consequences. And so by looking at the cost, they can see whether, you know, they're going into the hospital fewer times and all those kind of things. So I know they have actually quite a large number of outcome measures, but I don't have them off the top of my head. But I'll be happy to, that publication actually was before the trial, so it explained all of their methodology in there.
Great, thank you. And if I could just ask one other thing. So to what extent, the other thing is I think we recognize that the caregiving intervention research that's been done has oftentimes not followed necessarily the healthcare consequences. We've been trying to achieve good outcomes, but it hasn't really looked at the trajectory. Is there work going on around that issue that I think is also, you know, unrecognized caregivers? You know, I go to my doctor's office and I'm not going for my mother, I'm going for me, but no one knows that this is part of my stress.
Right. I mean, yes, it's been actually going on for a long time. There's quite a bit of research showing exactly that, that it, there are all kinds of consequences, not just for the person, but for the people taking care of them. We do fund quite a bit of research on caregivers and other health outcomes, yes.
But feedback into the healthcare system about how to address that independent of the person.
Right. So again, as I mentioned, this is one of those things where there's research showing some of these things, but getting the word out is quite difficult. So, I mean, I think the Alzheimer's Association, that facts and figures that just came out, you know, those statistics were known before, but when they do that, it gets the word out, and a lot of people hear about it, and they say, oh, wait, maybe that's what's going on with my parents. So, you know, we're all doing the best we can to try to get the word out, but More is better. Another question?
In community social work, when we're dealing with lower income clients, especially those on Medicaid, what we are encountering is primary care physicians who may make a dementia diagnosis, but they really don't want to pursue testing. They make referrals to neurologists and psychiatrists. But then when we try to find a neurologist or a psychiatrist who will evaluate the client, we find that they are either not accepting Medicaid, and many not even dealing with Medicare only. You have to have a secondary insurance other than Medicaid. So I guess what I'm wondering is if somewhere in the research there is a focus on the changes in Medicare and Medicaid, which seem to be going in the opposite direction, or certainly not in the same direction as the research for better identification and treatment.
Can you say more about what you mean by that, that it's going in the opposite direction?
Well, in Virginia, if you have Medicaid only, you get put into a managed care program. And there may be only one or two neurologists in Northern Virginia who may participate in that program. And getting an appointment, getting transportation to that appointment, getting translation services for that appointment, make it sometimes too difficult for our clients to follow up.
Right. I, as an NIA employee, can't really comment exactly on that. However, I would encourage you, number one, to talk to the Alzheimer's Association because they can help with policy changes. And number two, I would strongly encourage you to submit public comments to this advisory council for the National Alzheimer's Project Act, because they are dealing with some of those issues, and it's great for them to hear about what's going on in the community, in the real world. So, you know, if something needs to be changed and you see a great way to do it, put your comments out there. I think that would be great. Other questions?
So I'm asking, what's your personal professional opinion about the task force not recommending early cognitive impairment screening, given the fact that we now know that lifestyle and basic things like diet does reduce the incidence of Alzheimer's? What do you think about that?
You're talking about the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force recommendation?
Yes.
So I have to try to be really careful how to answer that. So they have a certain prescribed way they do things. And they have to look through what exists in the literature and what the evidence is. And that's what they did. And they came out with the finding that there's insufficient evidence, which there is. So, you know, that's up to us at NIA to fund research to provide that evidence. So it doesn't mean that people shouldn't have their cognition assessed, especially if they have complaints. It does not mean that. What it means is there's not sufficient evidence for them to recommend screening broadly. So I think it's fair. It's the message that comes across is probably not so great. But I think that, you know, they did what their job is, and they did it appropriately. And I think it's up to others of us who are aware of the benefits of knowing that you have an impairment, the benefits to the family, the benefits to the person. If there is actual impairment, that needs to be assessed, and the whole family needs help. So I think it's a problem in the messaging, and also lack of enough information to make a strong statement that it's important to screen everybody. We can't say that right now. So that's unfortunate, but that's kind of the current state. Okay, Bob, I guess there's time for a quick question.
I was just thinking this question that's so true, having been a social worker for many years, that each state, Medicaid is different. Some have managed care, some don't. That the delivery of care has a lot to do with how good the consultant services are, primary care, that kind of thing. Is there any NIA or any way that you could do research that would look at Medicaid delivery of care or how we get the services to the person? Because that's not an experimental design. That's a complexity. But that's where I think policy sometimes has right. to come from a national body like yourself that says, you know, in not doing that, you have uncompensated care or other expenses. But is there any cost benefit or any research that you're doing that really tries to get at the fact that our policies are out of whack, particularly for the poor in Medicaid?
As I was describing our infrastructure in the NIA, we have a division of behavior and social research, and they run a lot of large-scale studies, like the health and retirement study and others that utilize very large databases, including Medicare databases. And so they do have the capacity, they fund research to look at some of the types of questions that you're talking about. But it's not an area that I'm as familiar with, but I'd be happy to put you in touch with someone who might be able to give you better answers than I can.
Would that have to come from a research center, or could that be provider? You'd have to go to Virginia Commonwealth or another center. You couldn't just do that as a individual provider or provider group. It has to be more.
Well, let's talk afterward, because I'm not sure I'm completely understanding exactly what research question you're getting at. Okay, thank you, everybody, and I'll be around if anyone has any questions later. Thank you.